some announcements. We have several different things going on. So everything we have going on is on our website. You'll see right there. If you go to our Facebook page, you guys can find the link to our calendar where everything is. All the links to everything are on there. We're putting together some Easter baskets since we can't do our Easter egg hunt this year. We've got probably 25 more we can put together. So if you know of anybody that would like to donate like the plastic eggs or some candy or like peanut butter crackers or anything like that, would be willing to take those off your hands. Even little like matchbox cars or stuff like that. And we're able to continue our partnership with a couple of the local churches for our Good Friday, community Good Friday.
No.
However, since we have to practice the social distancing, we've been relegated to pre-recording it and using one of us from each church. And then Laura is leading the music for it. And we're going to release the video for that on Good Friday evening. So make sure you stay tuned to the Facebook page and things like that as the date gets closer to that. All right.
Stop it.
Y'all ready to sing?
We can't hear.
Yes.
Here. Can you hear me now?
Get off and then get back on.
Yeah. We're going to do that. We'll be back.
Okay.
Yeah, maybe. Just kidding. We're coming. We're gonna leave. Then we're coming back.
Okay. We'll wait for them then. Can you guys hear me fine, Tina, Keenan?
Yeah.
We can hear you. Can't see you.
Oh, that's because I'm presenting right now. That's why. Can you see me now?
Yep.
Yeah. That's why. Yvonne, is everybody else coming in or no? You're muted.
I just found it. Ah, ha, ha. Got it. All right, now you can set us back up there.
How did you do it like that one? I just answered.
All right, we ready, girls?
Yeah, ish.
Got it. All right, let me share this real quick. Okay, here we go. Can everybody hear it all right?
Yeah.
I see the King of Glory coming on the cloud.
Happiness.
Love and mercy. Watching over the people. Hosanna, Hosanna,
Oh, here we go. Jolyn,
hello.
In the Lord's Prayer, please.
Yes. Can you guys please join me in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father,
Father,
your name is holy. May your kingdom come and your
and
will,
be done.
Here on earth.
As it is in heaven.
Give us our daily bread, and forgive us our wrongs, as we will forgive those who have wronged us. Help us to avoid temptation, and deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. Next song, guys.
Lobster.
It be your name in the land and tickle where your strength of abundance
flows. It be your name.
Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. So I walk through the wilderness.
Blessed be your name.
Every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, still I will stand. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun is shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be
your name.
Blessed be your name, for the road marked with suffering, for the pain of suffering. Blessed be your name. Every blessing comes and back to where it is. When the darkness closes in, still I will listen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Give and take away. Give and take away. My heart will choose to stay. Lord, bless me be your name. Every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Give and take away. Give and take away. My heart
will choose to pray. Blessed be your name.
All right, guys. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you humbly today to praise your holy name. Put you on that pedestal because you are our King of Kings. You are our Lord of Lords. You are the one that has given everything for us. May our sacrifice in this time just be a small piece of your sacrifice. See, even the dogs are praising God. Look at this. Okay. So our scripture today, guys, is coming from Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 11. And it goes like this. As Jesus and the disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the town of Bethphage on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent two of them on ahead. "Go into the village over there," he said. "As soon as you enter it, you will see a donkey tied there with its colt beside it. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone asks what you're doing, just say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will immediately let you take them." This took place to fulfill the prophecy that said, "Tell the people of Jerusalem, your king is coming to you. He is humble, riding on a donkey's colt." The two disciples did as Jesus commanded. They brought the donkey and the colt to him and threw their garments over the colt, and he sat on it. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and the others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the people all around him were shouting, "Praise God for the Son of David. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise God in highest heaven." The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered. "Who is this?" they asked. And the crowds replied, "It is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." So, all right, I'm going to turn this off for a second so we can talk. So, this week, we took a little bit of last week off, and you guys can unmute yourself now so we can all talk and have our discussion. Can everybody see me now?
I have too much background right now, so when I want to talk, I'll just unmute it.
Okay, that's fine. Okay, so this week, our sermon series is going to start our discussions on what Holy Week is. So how many of you guys have heard what Holy Week is? Or what makes up Holy Week?
Good Friday, Palm Sunday.
Okay, it starts with Palm Sunday.
Mm-hmm. Then Good Friday, then Easter.
Yep. So there's actually more to it than that. So there's Good Friday, or I'm sorry, there's Palm Sunday, which is actually next Sunday. So we're studying Palm Sunday today, so we can kind of stay at, woo-wee, girls!
Make sorry. Me dance.
So we're starting Palm Sunday today. That way we can do Good Friday next week in preparation for the Good Friday service. But Palm Sunday is called the Triumphant Entrance. And so this is where Jesus came in and they got the idea that he is the true Messiah. People were finally starting to get this. So Palm Sunday starts the week. And then there's Maundy Thursday, which was the day of Pentecost, where they ate the Last Supper and where our communion sacrament comes from. And then there's Good Friday. Who knows what Good Friday is?
The day he hung on the cross.
Yes. Good Friday is the day Jesus died on the cross and that the veil was torn. The new covenant between God and us was born that day. And then there's Holy Saturday, where Jesus was laid to rest. And then there's Easter. So Jesus died on Friday. And you remember, have you guys heard where on the third day he rose again?
Yeah.
So he died on Friday, and on Sunday, Easter Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. So that's the day that he rose. So in studying Palm Sunday, our church calendar kind of invites us into different sorts of spirituality. So there's more to the church calendar than just like Holy Week and things like that. We celebrate Pentecost and things of that nature. Have you guys ever noticed how our tablecloths and the drape on the cross changes color and the lights behind the cross change color? That's all because of our church calendar. So the church calendar has different colors that represent different things. All these different things that take place in the church calendar, like the weeks leading up to Christmas, are called Advent. And it's a time of preparation, and it's a time of us really soaking in what these things mean, what Jesus did, what God was doing for us. This 40 days, not counting the Sundays leading up from Ash Wednesday, which, you know, we have Fat Tuesday. Yeah, have you guys heard of Fat Tuesday?
No.
Fat Tuesday is where you eat whatever you want, basically, because people tend to fast from things. Fasting is a way of sacrificing and giving things up to be closer to God. So in these 40 days, we've changed that color to purple. Purple is the color of royalty. So we're remembering who Jesus was and that he was our king and what he's done for us. So Lent prepares us for Jesus's death and resurrection, the ultimate sacrifice for all of us and for the forgiveness of all our sins and for the new covenant between God and us. And when we sync our lives up with this church calendar and the rhythm of Jesus's life, and this is probably more true with Holy Week than any other time, it's us really walking with Jesus and, you know, really taking on the life of Jesus, which we should be doing as Christians anyway. So, guys, tell me what you think of when you think of a hero.
When we think of a hero?
Yeah. What do you guys think of when you think of a hero?
Someone who saves the day?
What was that?
Someone who saves the day.
Someone who saves the day. So would it be like a firefighter or maybe, you know, somebody that's in the military or something like that? Do you guys consider them a hero?
All the above. Like,
okay.
Yep.
So if we learn about a little bit of the people back in that time, their heroes were considered military people. So here comes, and that's who they thought the Messiah was going to be, was some great military hero that comes to save the day. But that wasn't Jesus. Jesus was this carpenter. And so somebody that did something so great totally changed their perception of what the Messiah was, because it wasn't somebody that's this great, big, powerful person. He was somebody just like you and me. The only difference is he didn't sin. And we're human, so we're not capable of that. And so what he did was he really humbled himself to go on that cross. Could he have said no? Yeah, he could have. But that's not what he wanted for us. That's not the love that he had for us. You know, right now we're in a time of really sacrificing and suffering.
Yeah.
And kind of humbling ourselves through this. So there's really no better time to understand who Jesus was, because are we necessarily sacrificing and suffering for ourselves? Not really. We're sacrificing and suffering for, like, our friends, our family, you know, so we don't make them sick if we contract it. So, if we study the context of this, Matthew referenced in his scripture about fulfilling prophecy, right? So he's taking what he's saying from Isaiah 62, verse 11, when he's talking to daughter Zion. And daughter Zion is Jerusalem. But there's also a bit of context and prophecy that he's talking about that comes from Zechariah chapter 9. And I'll read that to you. Chapter 9, verse 9 through 13. And it says, "Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See your king come to you, righteous and victorious, lowly and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. As for you, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners from the waterless pit. Return to your fortress, you prisoners of hope. Even now I announce that I will restore twice as much to you." So clear back in the Old Testament, Isaiah, the prophet, we're talking about Jesus. They didn't know when, just like we don't know when any of this is going to happen. Could God end the world today and Jesus come back? Yep. But you know what? None of this is for us to know. But all this was foretold in the Bible. From Jesus' coming to Jesus' resurrection and all of that. Everybody in the history of ever has been preparing us for Jesus. Not just Jesus' coming during Holy Week, but for Jesus' return for all eternity. For us to be with him for all eternity. So if we really sync our lives up to Jesus and what Jesus would be doing and who Jesus would be loving during this time and what he would be acting like, then we are the church. As Christians, we should remember that this is the king that we're following. Yes, there's leaders. We have a president, things like that. But we should be really following our king. Our lives should be patterned after his. And we should also recognize that Jesus asked his disciples to do something very odd at the beginning of this passage. But it was all to fulfill God's wonderful plan. When we're called to do things for Christ that don't make sense from our current perspective, we should trust him anyway. How often do we really trust what Jesus taught in our day-to-day lives? Anybody?
What was the question?
How often do we really trust what Jesus taught and who Jesus was in our everyday lives?
All the time. I mean, we trust him in everything.
Okay.
I think we trust him, but we don't always follow him. You know, sometimes okay. We're not strong enough to follow him. Sometimes we're not for sure, because you have to understand to differentiate between modern times versus biblical times can be quite difficult.
Yeah. And that's part of studying the Bible, is really getting back to the context and what the people were like at the time. They're really not that much different. Were times different? Yeah. But they went through some of the same crap that we did. You know, they went through all these plagues and things like that, you know, just like we're going through now. They dealt with mental health issues, just like we do now. It just wasn't spoke of as predominantly as it is now. So I know me, I have trust issues. And sometimes that does come to trusting God instead of trusting what the world tells me. You know, even with leading this church, I've told some people, you know, here I am listening to these people about what the world says we can do, when I really should be trusting the vision that God's given me for this church and fully leaning on what I know to be of God and leading like Jesus would be leading. It's not easy. So what do you guys find is your greatest struggle in leading lives like Jesus?
Dealing with others.
Can you be specific?
You're supposed to love others like Jesus did, and it's not always so easy.
Yeah.
When people say, act, or do the things they do.
Yeah. Especially in this crazy time when you work in retail, right, girls?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I got some spit on. I know. How do you got spit on, our manager?
No kidding.
Yeah, smacked in the face.
Wow. Holy cow.
So, the objects that are coming in.
What do you guys find is the biggest struggle dealing with this social distancing right now?
Do what?
What do you guys find is the biggest struggle dealing with the social distancing right now?
Being locked down, not being able to see our families, getting tired of the same people with the same attitudes every single day.
Yeah.
Not being able to get out of here. And it sucks for all of us. It really does. It sucks for everybody.
Yeah. I that was one of my concerns for you girls. I'm like, holy crap.
Each other when it, yeah.
I know when I saw Yvonne the other day at Dollar Tree, I asked her how things were going.
Hard. So I had an RN from the hospital come in today.
My hour started, it wasn't scared at all.
And she said that the teacher that had to put in the survivors that didn't count is already sent at home and supported.
Wow.
That people are taking this situation out of the store. Yes, that it is.
If you know anything, go to CDC website. You can't trust that.
Yeah,
anything.
Yep, this nurse said that. Supposedly,
that's why it's so misleading. Well, I didn't know if you can't believe because it's like all the other viruses. They didn't go on the
airlines. That's why you need to go back to CDC and look at it. They have a website.
Don't take leave, ibuprofen, or any Advil. Most people that are that do have the virus, that accelerates it, and then that's why they're in the hospital. Like almost everyone's pretty much got it already.
So, when you think about this, guys. I do think you guys are doing the right thing. I really do. Is it easy? No. But the thing is, so God does put people in a position of leadership and knowledge and education and things like that to help protect us too. So when you're listening to people, I want you to be really, really careful in your discernment listening to people. Because there's a ton of false prophets out there right now, guys. A ton. So use reputable sources, the CDC, your doctors, the hospitals, healthcare professionals. sometimes the government. We have to listen to them, guys. Is this going to go away anytime soon? No. If you guys need anybody to call that's not in the house, that doesn't know what's going on, just to vent to, you guys got my number. You can call any one of us. Tina, Jolynn, me. Bob's not on the call today, but I'm sure Bob would take a call. You guys can call us. You know, not a big deal. We love you, and we know it's not easy for you guys. Have any prayer requests? Nobody wants to pray for anything.
I think that we need to say a prayer for these girls. These girls of the Heart House who feel like they, you know, they're really suffering because they're segregated from everything and everyone.
Okay. Tina, Keenan, you got anything you want to
pray for? Well, I know that God's going to take care of this and everything's going to work out to his glory, but, you know, prayer for all the people that have the coronavirus and, you know, prayer for the people that are uncomfortable having to social distance and not getting to be able to do what they do.
Okay. Tina, you got anything?
Keenan's dad's house.
Okay.
It's a whole thing.
Gotcha. Kirk, you got anything? Earth to Kirk.
Are you there? I don't think he's there anymore.
Pray for, dropped out. Pray for Sunday and Cindy. They're sick.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
And Corey. And Corey.
Cindy and Corey.
And Sunday.
Okay.
Cindy, Sunday. Cindy, her son and grandson
had her son and her grandson.
Okay. Riley, you got anything you want to pray for?
We don't know. It's okay. Going to be here.
All right, guys, let's pray.
Nikki?
Yeah?
Missy's got something.
Oh.
Please say a prayer for my husband, Joe. He's going to court tomorrow. Just
though,
maybe hopefully he'll be able to go
for
the next step of his journey.
Okay.
Also, I want to say a prayer for my friend that I've been trying to help get in recovery. She has court tomorrow too, and finds out if she's released or not.
Okay. Do you want to give her a name or no?
Her name's Stephanie.
Okay. All right, let's pray, guys. Father God, we thank you for our lives and the time that we can spend with you, being close to you. Allow us the peace that the Holy Spirit brings, the peace that passes all understanding. Allow it to guard our hearts and minds as we strive to live like Jesus, to love like Jesus. It's not easy, especially now. We want to lift these girls up to you. This is a really, really rough situation. Allow them to communicate their feelings effectively. May they be at peace with communicating those feelings. And may they be able to stay calm and everybody be rational and level-headed, because that is so important in this time. God, this is hard. So hard. We're not used to this. We're used to being out in the world around people. Not just around the same people, but being able to love your people and be around your people each and every day. So let us be your hands and feet in this time. When we're with our families, when we're with the Heart and House family, allow us to always keep you in mind and the love that you taught us. And sometimes hold our tongues, because we can't take back some of what we say. And we don't intend to hurt people. So Father God, I raise these girls to you. I ask for you to guard their minds in this time, to help them heal more fully in this time, and to focus on you in this time. We also raise to you all the people, the hundreds of thousands or millions of people that will be affected by this virus. For our healthcare workers that are putting their own lives at risk to save others, our heroes. For the support system of the healthcare workers. Lord, we know that they can't be around their families because the risk is so high. And we can't fathom that amount of isolation. Only you can. We pray for your miraculous healing for those that are diagnosed with COVID-19. We pray that you spare the lives of these people. God, we pray right now for Kenan's dad's house, for the situation going on there. We pray that your presence be known and your will be done. We also pray for the Stockwells and the Sewells, for the families that our church began taking care of right before this virus hit. You know, they lost a son, a friend, beloved person, right before this hit. So in their time of grief, they're not even really allowed to grieve because they've got to deal with this. So we ask your special protection over them and your love and your guidance. God, just be with them. And may your presence be so mighty that there is no denying you, and that they find a relationship with you. We pray for Sunday and Cindy and Corey in their time of illness. We pray that you just touch them right now and you bring miraculous healing to them, because we know you are the great physician and that it is through you all things can and will be done. God, heal them now. Hear my words. Hear my plea for this entire group. God, we pray for Missy's husband, Joe, that you show him your grace and your mercy that only you provide. May you bring him through this journey May he become closer to you than ever, ever before. God, we pray for your loving arms to wrap around him right now, and for him to know that he's not alone in this journey. Just like not one of us are walking this earth alone. You're right here with us, each and every step. And Lord, we raise Stephanie to you. We raise her recovery to you. And we commit this recovery to you. The same with all these girls and each and every one of us that are dealing with some sort of challenge. We give it to you right now. We trust that all these things can and will be done through the body and the blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. May you have mercy on us each and every day. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, guys, last song. Oh, let me get back to where I can put it up there for you. Do-do-do-do-do. Can you see it?
Love to see yeah.
All right. Lord, I lift your praise. Lord, I love to sing your praise. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to show the way from the earth,
from the cross, my death,
from the cross,
from the grave, to the sky, I lift your name on high.
You came from heaven to earth to show the earth you my death
to pay the cross
to the grave
to the sky.
I lift you high. You came from heaven to show the way from the earth to the cross, my death
to pay from the cross to the grave,
from the grave
to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lift your name
on high.
All right, guys. So if there is anything you take from today, know that we are with you in this. Every single one of you. We are one body. The body of Christ. The church. And this is what we're supposed to do, is we're supposed to really, really love people really, really well in this time. So if there's anything you guys need, don't hesitate. I can private message one of you girls in the house these phone numbers if you want, whatever you guys need. Tina Keenan, same goes for you. Jolynn Kirk, the same goes for you. If you guys need anything, let somebody know. Cool?
Cool. Yep.
All right. So, have a blessed week.
Bye, Nikki.
Bye, guys. I will see you later.
Thank you.
You're welcome.